Alrighty guys, so last time we finished chapter 6, so now you all know everything there is to know about gases, how gases work, and how they compress, and what happens when you heat them, what happens when you cool them. I did tell you to go ahead and read in your book, Guy Lussac's Law and Dalton's Law. Very simple concept. Dalton is just basically add up the partial pressures and you're good to go. Very, very simple stuff. So now we're going to move on to solutions, and that's chapter 7. And we do have an exam next week, so be prepared for that too. Everything up to what we covered today. So today will be part of your exam next week. Make sure you know that. Alright, solutions. Now, I once gave a quiz on solutions, and I got the most creative answer I've ever gotten from a student when I asked them to define the word solution. Although I marked it wrong, they were literally correct. They weren't chemically correct. The student wrote down that a solution is an answer to a problem. Which I chuckled at. I thought that was very clever. Still marked it wrong. But it was clever. It's a clever answer. When you don't know, just say something clever. You know, you never know who might laugh and give you a point just for making them laugh. But now, a solution is not an answer to a problem. A solution, here's what I want you to write down for me. They're homogeneous. Mixture of two or more things. A homogeneous mixture. So homogeneous, remember, is the same throughout the mix. So wherever you look inside the mixture, you see the same things. So that's a solution. A homogeneous mixture of two or more things. Now notice I didn't say it's a liquid. I didn't say it's a gas. I didn't say it's a solid. You can in fact have solutions of all three. You can have a solution of metals. Your gold ring on your finger, for example, is not pure, well, likely is not pure gold. It's likely 14 karat gold. That's a solution. It's gold mixed with something else to make it stronger. The air in this room is not pure. It's a solution of nitrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide, and all the other trace gases. Water as well. but by far, the most common types of solutions people think about are liquid solutions. For example, salt water. Best example I can think of, Kool-Aid. Don't say you don't like Kool-Aid. Everyone tries to deny it, but everyone loves Kool-Aid. Whether you like it or not. Remember when your mom used to mix a batch of Kool-Aid on summer day? Of course, in Florida, every day is summer day, whatever. That's a solution. You take two things or more and mix them together to make a homogeneous solution. Okay? Now, the words solute and solvent. Let's write those down. This word, I'm pretty sure all of you have heard of. Solvent. The solvent is what does the dissolving, right? That's what everyone usually says, and that's not a bad definition. But the solvent is what, when you want to define a solvent, it's the part of a solution in the greatest amount. So if you have a solution of Kool-Aid, you put a little pack of Kool-Aid in there, a little bit of sugar, mix it up with a whole bunch of water. Water, in that case, is the solvent. Not because it's dissolving everything, but because it's in there in the greatest number. There's more water in there than anything else. So we call that the solvent. Now the solute, you probably haven't heard of. If you have, good for you. That is what gets dissolved. What gets dissolved? So in a Kool-Aid mix, the Kool-Aid pack and the sugar get dissolved. So that's the solute. It's in there in the lowest amounts. Okay? Now you may have more than one solute. Oftentimes you do. For example, Kool-Aid. You have a little Kool-Aid pack. But in that Kool-Aid pack, there's probably food coloring, some kind of flavoring agents, probably some stabilizers and binders, and then you dump in a bunch of sugar. So there's a whole bunch of solutes in Kool-Aid, right? Not just one. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But it's still a solution. Now how do we know it's a solution? We stir it, we pour it in a glass, and everything is the same. Just visually look at it, the color doesn't change from top to bottom. It does, and you stir it a little more. But if it does, if it has a different color pattern from top to bottom, that would be cool. But it doesn't. Okay? It's homogeneous throughout. It's a solution. Make sense? Go to the ocean. Get a big old glass of seawater. Filter out the seaweed and the other stones and stuff. But the water looking stuff, is a solution. A whole bunch of different salts and environmental pollutants and water. Water is the solvent. Everything else dissolved in it is the solvent. It's all you. Okay? Is that pretty clear? Definitions are just what they are. You just gotta know. Now, solutes. They spread evenly through the solution, so it's homogeneous. The next, second point, they cannot be separated by filtration. You can run Kool-Aid through a filter all day long, and the Kool-Aid's gonna come out. You're never, ever, ever gonna separate the Kool-Aid molecules from the water. Not by filtration, anyway. Okay? So a solution will pour right through a filter. You won't even slow it down. Now, if you want to get the Kool-Aid back, let's say you've made your Kool-Aid and you have buyer's remorse, you want to return the Kool-Aid to the store, you have to evaporate the water back off, scrape out the Kool-Aid and put it back in the pouch and take it back to the store. Okay? To do that, you just take the water or the solution that you've made and you boil it on the stove. The water will evaporate and the Kool-Aid particles will remain at the bottom. Okay? And of course they're not visible, you can't see them, you know that. So whenever you think of a solution, I think about Kool-Aid. It's like the best solution ever, except for beer. Beer is also a solution.
To a problem, or?
That too. A temporary fix to a big problem. All right. That's not too hard, right?
No.
You guys are all good. You guys all got that now, right? Excellent. Now let's talk about water. Water is by far the most popular and common solvent on the earth. Water is amazing in what it can do. Water can dissolve basically anything to a point. Even oil. Water can dissolve oil, not very well to a point, but it can dissolve some of it. Again, not very well. That's why we have an oil disaster in the ocean. The oil sits on the top, doesn't dissolve into the ocean very well. But there are measurable quantities that will dissolve into the water. Now, it's not huge, but it's there. Okay. Now, water is H2O. We know that the hydrogens are delta positive. The oxygen is delta negative. So now, whenever you throw in something, say like salt, into sugar, it dissolves right away. Water has the innate ability to dissolve sodium chloride. So sodium is positive, so what will happen is the oxygen from the water and their delta minuses will coordinate somehow to the sodium and make it nice and happy to be there. There you go. So there's a sodium ion being surrounded now by water molecules trying to make it comfortable to be in that water environment, to strip it away from its chloride. And then, of course, chloride being negative. Oops. Will not bond to the oxygen, or not interact, with the oxygen, but with the hydrogens, because they're delta positive. And so on. We'll do a few more waters than that. But it'll interact with those delta positively charged hydrogen. So that's what makes water such a really good solvent, because these deltas, this delta positives and delta negatives, they're big. They're actually quite large. The difference in electronegativity between the two is substantial. So it's a very good solvent because it's very polar. Now, the word polar draws to mind a certain thing. Remember we talked about polarity, bond polarity, and molecular polarity? And we said that, using electronegativities, we can kind of figure out who's polar and who's not. Water is polar. And I just showed you how water can interact with cations and anions. So, I don't know if we ever talked about this, but let's talk about sodium chloride. That's ionic. Okay? Ionic bonds, by definition, are extremely polar. Because you have a plus side and a minus side, right? There's no bond between them, so they're just attracted to each other. It's called ionic bonding. So they're polar. Salt dissolves in water very well. One way you can look at that is to say, well, water's polar, salt is polar. Polar things must dissolve polar things. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Now, you guys don't really know much about sugar, but I'll just tell you, you'll have to trust me. Sugar is polar, very polar. If I told you that, which I just did, sugar is polar. Knowing that, water should dissolve sugar, right? Yeah. And it does all day long, right? Water is very good at dissolving sugar. Because it's Friday, feeling a little, risky today. Alcohol!
Yes.
There you go. It's polar. Can water dissolve alcohol? Yes. Beer, wine, whiskey. It's all alcohol dissolved in water. Okay? Water dissolves polar things. Loves to all day long. Okay? But on the reverse side of that, non-polar. Stuff like gasoline. Did you ever go to the gasoline store? Okay, go to the gasoline store. Service station. And buy gas, and then you pull the pump out, and the little drip of gasoline falls to the ground into a puddle. Did you ever do that? You ever see that? And it forms that rainbow-looking thing on top of the puddle. What that is the gas is spreading out onto the surface of the water. The little drop of gasoline is spreading out to a really thin layer on top of the water, but it is not dissolving in the water. Okay? Gasoline and oil products don't dissolve the water very well. Now, I'll tell you, gasoline and most oil products are non-polar. They're a bunch of carbons bonded to each other, so it's not polar. So does it make sense then that water wouldn't be able to dissolve it?
Yes.
Because water is polar. Are you with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Now, let me think of an example at your house. I got one. Do you ever spill grease on your shirt? Don't say you haven't, because everyone spills grease on themselves. You're at a restaurant eating with your best friend or a lovely lady or a nice gentleman, and dollars to donuts, you're going to drop a meatball on your shirt. Never, ever, ever go for spaghetti on your first date. That's a one. You spill something on your shirt, there's grease in the food. The grease stains your best shirt. So what do? You wash it. But what do you do before you wash it? All the ladies know this. You soak it with soap. Right? You put a little detergent on there, rub it. Detergents are non-polar. You with me? Grease from the food is non-polar. So the detergent, you rub it on the shirt, you're hoping it will dissolve the grease on your shirt. Make sense? You with me so far?
Yeah.
Human beings. Don't do this, but you do it when you're home alone. If you rub your face, don't do it. Rub your face, you're probably not dry. You probably got some slime to you. Don't do it. We all have it. We all have it. I mean, everyone's laughing. We all have it. We all have a little bit of oil, especially on our hands. Our clothes get that oil all the time. Like every time you wear clothes, your oil transfers to your clothes. It just happens. So we wash it in detergent. Or soap. Why? Because soap has a non-polar feature to it to dissolve that oil, to wash it away, so our clothes don't stink and they don't stand up on their own. Right? Non-polar. Now guys, every guy, and maybe some ladies too, have an old junker car in your driveway. The old junker car leaks oil onto your beautiful paved driveway. That's unsightly, and every man in the world will eliminate that day. What do? We go to Home Depot, Lowe's, some auto body shop or someplace, and we buy oil stain remover, or whatever it's called. The oil on the driveway is non-polar. The oil stain remover is non-polar. They'll dissolve one another. So you can hopefully wash the spot away without making it bigger. This is what usually happens. Okay? So that being said, write this down. Like, L-I-K-E, dissolves like. Like dissolves like. Now that's a very simple saying that all chemists use. Like dissolves like. And what we mean by that is polar things dissolve polar things, non-polar things dissolve non-polar things. But polar things do not dissolve non-polar things, usually. And non-polar things do not usually dissolve polar things. Now, don't ever do this. because it's illegal. Please don't do it. But something people do is they put salt or sugar in people's gas tanks. Right? The reason why that's really bad is it'll clog your fuel filter up really bad. Why? Because sugar and salt will not dissolve in gasoline. Why? Sugar's polar, gas is nonpolar. Like does not dissolve, unlike. Okay? You with me so far? Alright, excellent. Now, electrolytes and non-electrolytes. Now, I want to show you a quick little YouTube video, which I think is funny. You probably will too, I hope. It's from a movie called Idiocracy. I hope I have volume here. Just crank it up. How come I'm not hearing that? Oh well, maybe it won't work. Nope, not gonna work. Come on now. How come there's no sound? Maybe that'll work. Oh, denied the movie. Come on. Well, anyway, this is funny. There you go. Stay out loud. Go ahead. Just Google search this stuff right here. Idiocracy, broad nose, the electrolysis. Write that down real quick if you're interested, and go check out the video. It's actually pretty funny. What they're doing is they're in this movie. The president, the main character in the movie has solved an exam problem that made him the smartest man in the world. This is in the future. He's kind of asleep or cryogenically frozen or some foolishness. They bring him back and he's now the smartest man in the world because everybody else has become so reliant on computers and stuff for everything that he's so smart because he could have 2+2. So they make him the science consultant to the White House. And they're basically trying to grow food now because they're all starving. Because they're all not very smart. And what they're doing is they're pouring Brondo, this thing called Brondo, on their crops to grow them. Brondo is basically Gatorade. They're spoofing Gatorade with Brondo. And they keep saying, their only argument to this guy, their only argument they have, is Brondo's got electrolytes. It's what plants crave. You'll see it in the video. And at one point in the video, he says, what are electrolytes? Do you even know? And they kind of look at each other and they're like, it's that stuff they used to make Brondo. Okay. It's kind of funny. I don't do it very well. But now, I play that video for this class because most people know we need electrolytes. You know, you hear bananas are high in electrolytes. Drink Gatorade because it's high in electrolytes. You hear all this stuff. And I always say to people, that's true, you need electrolytes. There's no doubt about that. You need to have electrolytes. But I always say, a good, cheap source of electrolytes, we live right beside it. Drive 20 minutes to the beach, take a big mouthful of seawater. What? Seawater is full of electrolytes. Ooh, that's gross, right? But it's true. Electrolytes are salt.
How long is that video? Because it pulled up two of them.
About a minute and 11 seconds.
Okay, so that's right.
Yeah, there's two of them there. One's a minute and 9, one's a minute and 11.
Okay.
So that's electrolytes. Now, sorry that the video didn't work, but you guys will have, you know, if you're all computer savvy, you can pull it up on your own. But it's usually fun to play that movie. So now we are going to define electrolytes. There are two basic kinds of electrolytes, strong and weak, and we're going to look at both of them. So now, for those of you who had lab, you've already been familiarized with this. We've already done an experiment with this. Where we have a light. Now here's just a light, just a regular incandescent light bulb. And it has power running to it, but now the power has been cut at the bottom. So the power coming in has been cut. So there's no path for the electricity to go through. So these two black probes that are sticking in the solution there, that's where the wire would normally run, we just cut it. And what we do is we put a solution of salt water underneath of it. And that salt water can conduct electricity through itself. And that's because there are electrolytes present in the water that can transfer the charge from one way to another. If you just put, say, sugar water under there, it wouldn't conduct electricity because sugar is not an electrolyte. Okay? So that's the gist of that experiment. Now, let's define some of these terms. Oops, there we go. Solutions and ionic charge in water. Now, this is in water. A strong electrolyte has nothing to do with how much it can bench press. It has everything to do with how much it can ionize. Strong electrolytes produce ions in solution and conduct electrical current. Okay? Strong electrolytes produce ions in solution. So That's a little bit of an understatement, I think. They produce ions in solution, and the parent molecule is gone. For example, this is a quintessential example of a strong electrolyte. Sodium chloride. This is a solid, this is sodium chloride is a solid. We'll give you sodium plus and Cl minus in solution. Aq, remember, means aqueous or dissolved in water. So in that solution, that's a strong electrolyte. You take the sodium chloride solid and you throw it into the water. In the water, you will find ions of sodium, ions of chloride, but you won't find any molecules of sodium chloride. That the little ionic bonds are totally broken. And the ions drift apart. Okay? That's a strong electrolyte. Now a weak electrolyte are things like, I'll just draw HF, hydrogen fluoride, and water. You get H plus plus F minus. Now, notice the arrow I've drawn it right here. Compare it to that one. This arrow goes 100% or all the way to the right, and there's no arrow going backwards. This one has an arrow going forward and an arrow going backwards. This is a big hint. That is weak. What that says, or what this equation is trying to say to you, is that in a solution of water, you will have H plus ions, F minus ions, but you'll also have HF molecules. They won't all disappear. In fact, you'll have a lot more HF molecules than you will ions of H and F minus. Okay? So strong, complete dissociation, ions here, ions there, no parent molecule at all. Weak electrolytes. You'll have some ions, some FH plus, some F minus, but a whole bunch of HF. That's weak. Okay? So now, a strong electrolyte conducts electricity very well. A weak electrolyte can still conduct electricity, just not very well. It does it at a lot slower rate. So the light, when you do these experiments, will turn on, but it'll be very dim. It won't be very bright. With me so far? Everybody? Now, the last one, non-electrolytes. Now, what usually happens with most students at the end of this chapter is they start to think that everything is either a strong or a weak electrolyte. And that's not true. There are a lot of things that are non-electrolytes. Things like sugar is a great example of a non-electrolyte. It dissolves 100% in water, no problem. You can dissolve it very easily in water, but you don't get any ions. That's the key. If you don't form ions, you are not an electrolyte. Are you with me on that? Everybody?
Yes.
Okay. So now, when looking at an equation to try to figure out if you have an electrolyte, look for charges. Okay? If you have charges, you have an electrolyte. Okay? Because electrolytes are basically charged particles. Sodium plus, chloride minus, potassium plus, sulfur minus, sulfide. Those are electrolytes. They have charged particles. So far, so good? Everybody like that?
Yes.
And a non-electrolyte cannot and will not conduct electricity very well. All right, so I went over all this stuff. Let's just move right along here. Solubility. Write that word down for me, please. Solubility. Solubility. The ability to dissolve something. Kind of cool. Kind of there. All right, solubility. Please write that definition down. Basically, solubility means how much stuff can a given amount of solvent dissolve. So how much Kool-Aid can I get into a gallon of water? That will be a solubility. How much sugar can I get to a pint of water? Be a solubility number. In chemistry, we typically express it in grams of solvent divided by 100 grams of water. That's typically how we express solubility. So, for example, something like sodium chloride you might be able to get, you know, 15 or 20 grams for 100 milliliters of water dissolved easily. Things like sugar, 15, 20, maybe even 30 grams per 100 grams of water, very soluble in water. Things like oil, you may only get 0.00001 grams to dissolve 100 milliliters of water. You may not get very much at all. Okay? Now, they're temperature sensitive. So what does that mean? That means if you warm them up, generally, you can dissolve more stuff. Generally. Now, being a Friday, nice weather. Mojito is a cocktail that you make with simple syrup. Right? There's some other crap in there, some mint, but it has simple syrup as one of its ingredients. Simple syrup is a solution of sugar and water. But now it's a little bit different. You actually warm it up. You actually heat up the water as you're adding the sugar so the water can dissolve more sugar. And then once it's dissolved it, it generally won't come back out of solution. Generally it will stay there. It's called a supersaturated solution. Also called a syrup. And that is an idea of how heating up the water can help it dissolve more sugar. Okay? Now you take that same sugar and cool it down in the freezer, or maybe not the freezer, the refrigerator, and that sugar might come back out of solution. It might just say, hey, I don't want to be in the water anymore, and come out. It could do that too. That's called rock candy, in case you're wondering. It's rather hard to make, believe it or not. Okay, so that's solubility. Keep moving on. Write that down. Unsaturated solution. An unsaturated solution contains less than the maximum amount of solute. Another way of saying it, if you have that solution of Kool-Aid in your fridge, or maybe nowadays it's Crystal Light, you pull that thing of Kool-Aid out, you pour a little glass to taste it, it's not sweet enough. So what do? You add more sugar, right? You take that glass and start adding tablespoons of sugar to your Kool-Aid and stirring it, right? So that original Kool-Aid you pulled from the refrigerator was unsaturated, because why do we know that, or how do we know that? We add more sugar, stir it, it dissolves. The water can accommodate more solute. It's not, it's called unsaturated. Now how do I usually explain this? Is I say, okay, go to the beach and take a towel, which hopefully you do anyway. Now, jump in the water, come back out, use your towel to dry off. Now your towel is wet, right? But you can still use it again, right? Because there's still some dry spots left. You can still dry off again. It's not saturated with water, right? But now take that same towel and jump in the ocean with it. Now that towel is filled with water, right? That towel is now saturated with water. You get the idea? The towel cannot hold any more water. Now, the towel you get out of the water, dry up with it, you can still dry yourself some more with it because it's unsaturated. Feel me? Jump in the water with it. It's waterlogged now. It is saturated with water. So the word unsaturated means you are not yet saturated with solute. You could add more stuff to the water or whatever solvent you're using. Does that make sense? Unsaturated. Now, saturated is the other one. Saturated solutions contain the maximum amount of solute that the solvent can dissolve. And the cool thing that happens in saturated solutions is a lot of solid stuff will form on the bottom, usually. You keep dumping in sugar into your Kool-Aid glass and keep stirring it. At some point, you add more sugar and all of a sudden, all you're doing is stirring and the sugar's just moving around. It's not dissolving anymore. Why is that? Because you've made that Kool-Aid saturated with sugar. And I would hate to be your dentist, but I bet you it tastes good. Come on, y'all. You all know it's going to taste good. And don't tell me y'all haven't done this. And people go, I would never do that. Sure. But you haven't lived. You have to supersaturate your Kool-Aid. Seriously, it tastes good. Of course, it's not good for you or your teeth. Still tastes good. Does that make sense, everybody? Everybody okay with that? Now, that's solutions, that's electrolytes, that's saturated, that's unsaturated. Okay? So now, most of the time in our society, we deal with unsaturated solutions, just because that's how it is. You don't need to add a lot of stuff to something to make it have good flavor. Okay, you don't need to add a lot of stuff to make it beneficial. Okay? For example, the air in this room could hold more oxygen. We could pump more oxygen in this room and it would go in nicely mixed with the air in here. But then everything becomes more flammable. See what I'm saying? So more is not always better. Anyway, concentrations. Write that down for me. Concentration of a solution. Now here's where we're going to do a little bit of math. Yeah, I know. The math is not hard though.
Yes, it is.
Oh, come on now. Mm-hmm. Not that hard. Okay, it's extraordinarily hard and you should cry and stop even trying right now. I don't think so. It's not that bad though, it really isn't. Okay. Concentration of a solution. Now that same student who had the quiz with the solution didn't know the answer, so gave me a creative one. The answer she gave for this one, or it might have been a he, I'm not sure. Concentration of a solution. They said, thinking really hard about finding the answer to a problem. it was very funny. She was very clever. He or she was very clever. This is not right. All right, concentration. The concentration of a solution is always expressed amount of solute divided by the amount of solution. It's always expressed that way. But there's numerous ways we can look at it. For example, mass percent. Mass percent, M over M. So mass of solute divided by mass of solution multiplied by 100. That's mass percent. So it's called a mass percentage, M over M. Mass over mass. There's volume percent. Volume over volume. That's the volume of solute divided by the volume of solution multiplied by 100%. And I will give you these formulas on an exam. You don't have to memorize. So that's two ways of expressing a concentration. And now these, and the next one I'm going to show you, but these two are very ubiquitous in our society. You may not have seen them, that's all. Now, I keep going back to alcohol. I don't even drink, you know, for those of you who don't really know, I don't drink. But I do like talking about alcohol because everyone else knows.
Don't drink?
What's that?
You said you really don't drink.
Not really, no. Mm-hmm. Not very often. But when you get to be 40, drinking is very bad because you drink one night, you have 4 days off. Oh, my head. So you just don't do it. Anyway, and also, so I want to have some calories. It's really bad for you. If you go to the store, and you go to the liquor store, and you buy rum, vodka, tequila, by law, it has to have, in writing on the label, how much alcohol there is in the bottle. Why they do that is not to make the consumer feel good. It's the company saying to the government, this is how much alcohol we have in our product, and here's how much taxes we have to pay. That's what it's all about. It's also called proofing. At one time it was important to the consumer, but now it's more important to the government. Now, you look at the bottle, and it says 40% alcohol by volume. Okay? Now, what does that mean? That means there's 40, now let's just show that now. There's 40% by volume. Alcohol. So that's what they said. There's 40% by volume alcohol in your general rum, tequila, vodka, whatever. So that means there are 40 milliliters of alcohol and 100 milliliters of rum, vodka, tequila, whatever. That's what it means. So if you buy, say, a liter of whatever, and it's 40% by volume, you'll have 400 milliliters and 1,000 milliliters of rum. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody? That's what they mean. That's what they're saying to you. Now, beer and all that other kind of stuff is right around 7. Wine is right around, what, 12, I think? Beer is like 5 to 7. They mean, so there's less alcohol in those products. Okay? This is what it means, there's less alcohol. So that's a volume over volume percentage. You ever buy peroxide from the pharmacy? It's usually a 3% by volume solution, right? That means there's 3 milliliters of peroxide every 100 milliliters of solution. Make sense? And the solvent in both cases is water. So far, so good? Mass percentage is less common. Sometimes you'll see it in the jewelry industry for metals, but it's very, very uncommon. Volume percentage is more common. Now, a mass over volume percentage. A mass over volume percentage is just what you think it's going to be. It's just what you think it's going to be. Mass over volume is M over V. That is mass of solute divided by the volume of solution. Multiply all that by 100. Now for all three of these, I want you to be very mindful of this. For all three of them, the denominator is always expressed by the solution. So it's the total mass of the solution, not the mass of the solvent. It's the mass of the total solution. The volume of the solution, not the volume of the solvent, the volume of the entire solution. The volume of the solution again, it's the entire volume of the solution, not the volume of the solvent. That's a common error. People put the volume of the solvent on the bottom, and that's not right, okay? Those are three percentage expressions. Of course, another place you see a volume to volume percentage is in the juice industry, right? 5% real juice. Should feel good about that. Two-year product, we had 5% real juice to make it sound fantastic. This is great. Molarity is how chemists do things. Write that down, underline it twice, put an exclamation point on both sides, and maybe give it some kind of, I don't know, baseball hat or something. You know, just to maybe draw your attention to it or something, I don't know. Make it obvious that it's important. Okay? Molarity. Molarity is moles of solute divided by liter of solution. Okay? Now, molarity is not expressed in percentages. Molarity is not a percentage. The other three, those are percentages. Molarity is not. It's just a ratio of moles over liters. But it's the liters of the entire solution, not just the solvent. Okay? And chemists prefer to use this one because it has our favorite little friend, the mole. The other three can't get you to moles without doing some other calculations. Molarity can get you right into moles. Okay? That's why chemists like to use it. Now we do, from time to time, use percentages in solution, but generally it's when it doesn't matter as much, it's not as critical. That's generally when we'll use percentages. Okay? So those are your four percentage expressions, and they will be provided to you on an exam. Now, let's just look at this problem right here. I'm not sure you can see it, so I'll write it down here in a minute. What we're doing on these two photographs is we're making a solution. And we're doing a mass over mass solution. Now the top scale, I'm dumping in some KCl, potassium chloride. So I'm just weighing it into the flask. And the scale says 8.00 grams. You may not be able to see it, but that's what it says, 8.00 grams. So let's look at this now. So I'm adding 8.00 grams of solute to the solution, to the beaker. So, 8.00 grams. Now, the bottom picture, I have a little blue squirt bottle there. That's water. I'm adding water to the beaker. So this potassium chloride is going to dissolve up nicely in the beaker, and that'll make a nice homogeneous solution, but I want to know the percentage of the solution. So I have two masses here. I have 50 grams total solution. So the solution itself is 50.00 grams. So I know the mass of the solvent, solute. I know the mass of the solution. I can get a percent from that, can't I? Mm-hmm. So all you gotta do is run back to the formula sheet. You'll find M over M percent is the mass of solute divided by the mass of solution multiplied by 100. And it's simple. The mass of the solute is 8.00 grams divided by 50.00 grams, multiplying it by 100 equals. Now I really don't have any idea. What's 8 divided by 50? It's what? 16.0?
Mm-hmm. Oh. It's 0.16, then you multiply it by 100.
Right, okay, so 16.0 then, right? Percent. Now, that's three sig figs, that's four. That one is exact. The 100 is an exact number in this calculation because percentages are defined to be out of 100, right? Mm-hmm. We all know that. So the 100 in this calculation is an exact number because it's a definition. Okay, so don't round to the 100. I know you're tempted to, but don't. Okay? Oh, and one other thing, I'm sorry, I meant to put this here. Mass over mass. That seems like a small point, but it's actually a very large point. If you don't tell the reader how you determined your percentage, the reader might confuse it with mass over volume, which is a more common way of expressing percentages. Okay? So at the end of your percentage calculation, put percent M over M, if it was a mass percentage, or M over V, or V over V. Make sure that's there. If it's not there, the reader might get confused and may do something terribly wrong. Okay? A lot of, yeah?
If it was just 16, would we have gotten it wrong?
I probably would mark it right. It's a small, such a small point, but just in your professional
the
career.
The sig figs?
Oh, the sig figs? Yeah, I'd give you one point off for that. You gotta get the sig figs right. Hospitals, IV bags are expressed in percentages, usually. 3% sodium chloride or potassium chloride or whatever in solution. Usually it's massive volume, I believe, in those instances. All right, so that's how you calculate that. Let's give this one the old college try, shall we? A solution is prepared by mixing 15.0 grams of sodium carbonate and 235 grams of H2O. Calculate the mass percentage, M over M, of this solution. Now, on this question, this is a very common question. It's very common how it's worded. This is exactly how they usually come out. Notice, you're not given the mass of the solution. You're given the mass of the water, the solvent. So in order to get the mass of the solution, you add them together. You add the solute, the 15, and you add the 235 together. That's the total mass of solution. Do you get the difference? The little subtle difference there? Anybody got it? One guy, good job. Hey, good job, Eric. Everybody else, are you getting to it? Or are you stuck? Mm-hmm. You're stuck, it's okay. Guys doing all right? Okay, so the mass of the solute is 15.0 grams. The mass of the solvent is 235. So to get this, we need to figure this out. This is what we don't have initially. We don't have the mass of solution. So to simply get the mass of the solution, we have to add those two numbers together. Everyone follow me on that? Mm-hmm. So 15.0 plus 235 equals 250 decimal point. So when you add these two together, there's no decimal points here. So you have to have only this, and there's this zero is significant. Okay, so it's 250 grams. And now we know the mass of the solute. That's 15.0 grams divided by 250 grams multiplied by 100 equals
6.00%
mass over mass. Not bad, right? You guys all got that. I know you guys have got it. You guys are a good group. So it's pretty straightforward, right, guys? All right, let's move on then to something more fun, such as molarity. Molarity takes a little bit more time, a little bit more effort, but it's not hard. So don't take your word for it now. Just think with me. It's easy. It's easy. Molarity, moles of solute divided by liters of solution. So now, we know everyone in this room knows how to convert grams to moles, right? Everyone in this room knows how to convert milliliters to liters, right? If I give you the formula, molarity equals moles over liters, you should have no problem calculating molarity, right? Does that make sense? Everybody?
Yeah.
I know there's some people that are a little bit worried. Trust me, it's not hard. Okay. What if, I'm just going to make up a problem here on the spot. So what if we wanted to have the molarity, what is the molarity? A solution if 735 grams of, I don't know, lithium chloride were dissolved in 2.5 liters of water. No, I don't want to do that way, I'm sorry. Were dissolved to a final volume of 2.5 liters. Now the reason I had to change it at the end was because if I just add 2.5 liters of water to 735 grams of material, what people often forget is that this mass, that sodium chloride or potassium chloride or lithium chloride, whatever it is you're dissolving, that has a volume too. So if you just take a mass, say a kilogram of salt, and you add a gallon of water, you get more than a gallon of solution. You follow me? Because the salt takes up space too. Right? Even though it dissolves and disappears, it's still taking up space. So I had to reword the question to say the final volume was 2.5 liters. Okay? So the final volume of solution is 2.5 liters. I didn't add 2.5 liters of solvent. I actually added less than that. All right. So now, we want, question mark, we want molarity. So we look at the formula sheet, and you see this. Capital M equals moles over liters. That's the standard expression for molarity. Molarity is expressed capital M. Molarity is capital M. Molarity is moles of solute divided by liters of solution. So of solute, liters of solution. Alrighty then. So now, We look at our question, we say, nowhere in that question does it tell us moles. Right. But we do know the grams, and we also know it's lithium chloride. With those two pieces of information, you can calculate moles. So let's just write some stuff down here. We know that the grams are 735, and we know we have lithium chloride. How do we convert grams to moles? What do we need? You said it. I thought you, one of you guys said it. Say louder. The grams were moles, right? There you go. I knew you knew it. You need to get grams or moles, right?
Yes.
And how do we get that? Periodic table, right? Molar mass. What is it in your book? It's just, the book has one decimal point, which is nice. So it's lithium. Oh, there's three decimal points. 6.941. Okay, lithium equals 6.941. What's chlorine?
35.45.
All right, so 6.941 plus 35.45 is a grand total of?
42.39. Do I need to
Yep, round it to two decimal points.
Okay, 39.
39? So there is something. We have the molecular mass of lithium chloride. Now, a piece of advice for you guys. If on an exam you get a question and you don't know anything, you're just total blank. If you can, convert something to moles. Convert everything in the question to moles if you have to. Because probably you're taking the correct step. I'm not guaranteeing you are, but probably you're taking at least one step in the right direction. Okay? And at least you'll get 2 out of 10 or 3 out of 10 for doing just that much. Okay? If you just have no idea how, now, if you know how to do it, and obviously converting to moles is the wrong step, don't do it. Because it doesn't work for every question. But a lot of times, the first correct step is converting something to moles. So now, to convert this to moles, we had to calculate that. So we did. 42.39 grams per mole. Everyone satisfied with that? Everyone know how to do it? Mm-hmm. Everybody good?
Yes.
All right.
Is this the answer?
No. Far from the answer. Molecular mass lithium chloride equals 42.39 grams per mole. All right. Let's get rid of that. Okay. So now, we need to figure out this. It's all about getting to here. It's all about getting to here. We're in grams. That's not moles. So now we need to take grams. We need to take grams, multiply it by something that will give us moles. We'll put the moles on top. There you go, grams at the bottom. And the grams should cancel out, leaving us in the unit that we need, moles. So then, we go ahead and we plug in the numbers. 735 goes right there. The 42.39 goes there, and the number 1 goes there. So 735 divided by 42.39 equals, what is it?
17.3
moles. That's a lot. It's a lot of material. Okay? So now, we have this. We have that. We just calculated it. 17.3. So if you want, write it down here. Moles of lithium chloride equals 17.3 moles. Put a box or something around it so you can see it. That's a very, very important number. Very important number. We're going to use it here in a hot second. Okay. So we've calculated molecular mass of lithium chloride. We convert grams of lithium chloride to moles using that molecular mass, And now we're going to solve the problem. So it's going to be 17.3 moles divided by, now we need the volume in liters. Well, look at that. It's already in liters, 2.5 liters. So divide this by 2.5 liters equals, so 17.3 divided by 2.5. What is it?
6.9.
Capital M. Or, if you put capital M, I would mark it right, or... If you did that, that would be fine too. If you wrote molarity, I would mark it right too. But these are your two. That's correct, and so is that. This is what you see normally, but that's still correct. I would mark it right. Okay? Now, I really like these questions. That will be a 10-point question, and there's a lot of things that I can grade you on here. First of all, can you identify that you have to convert to moles? Can you calculate a molecular weight? Can you convert grams to moles? Can you do, once you've converted from grams to moles, can you apply it to this formula? Once you've calculated your final answer, can you round it off correctly? There's a lot of stuff that goes on in one question. That's why I like them.
But we don't have to multiply that
for 100, no? No, it's not a percentage.
It's not a percentage. So it's
0.69. I don't have to calculate it. You tell me. 17? No, it can't be.
No, it's
can't be 0.69.
It's 2.5. I divided by 25.
Oh, okay. No worries. Yeah, if you divide by 25, you'd be right. There you go.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's how you do it. Now, there's nothing hard about that. There's nothing that you guys can't do. You've already done most of it. Now you're just applying it to a different formula. That formula, moles over liters, will be on your formula sheet, so you don't have to memorize that either. Try this one on for size. It has some help there on there. Calculate the grams per mole for you. What is the molarity of 0.500 liters of sodium hydroxide solution if it contains 6.00 grams of sodium hydroxide? So give me the molarity of that solution. And they've already calculated the molecular weight. And the mole, too. Not a lot of reporting. Go ahead and work that problem out. Stay back. There's some help there on the slide. We need to start. Anybody get it? You people? It's a little bit tougher than the percentage ones, but not too bad. Just keep trying. You'll get it. Keep trying. Okay, how's everyone doing? Everyone doing all right? All right, here's this question. Let's work it together. So malaria is our question mark. We don't know the malaria. So that's capital M. First thing you're gonna wanna do is go to your formula sheet and you're gonna see capital M, molarity, equals moles divided by liters. So nowhere in this question are we given moles. So there must be a way to figure it out. We know it's sodium hydroxide, we know it's 6 grams, and it even tells us on the slide what the molecular weight of sodium hydroxide is. So we have the grams, and we have its molecular weight, or mass, excuse me, molecular mass. It's a bad habit there. So we know grams, NaOH, multiplied by something will give us moles of NaOH, which is what we need to go right there. So we'll put the grams in the bottom, the moles in the top, and the grams will nicely cancel. So this is going to be 40.0, that will be the number one, and this will be 6.00. And that will convert us from grams to moles. So let's crank that out real quick. 6 divided by 40 equals 0.150 moles. And if you want, put a box around that. So you draw your attention to it during an exam, and I can see it too. Alright, so we calculated moles. We still don't have the answer. The answer is molarity. But we have one piece of the puzzle. The other piece of the puzzle is volume of solution. It says in the question, 0.500 liters. Remember, in molarity, the volume must always be expressed in liters. So if you're given a volume in milliliters, convert it to liters. Make sense? All right, so then, molarity is moles over liters. That's going to be 0.150 moles. Divide all of that by 0.500 liters equals, what is it, 0.3?
0.3.
And put a square around the answer, make sure your sig figs are correct, and then take the bow. Even on exam, go, ta-da, move forward, yeah. Oh, sorry, you had a question too. Sorry, his hand was out first. I thought you were stretching.
Where is the 2 zeros and the 3 coming
from? That's the significant figures. So here, there are 3 sig figs, and here, there are 3 sig figs. So when you do a division, your sig figs have to match the worst measurement. Mm-hmm. So there's 3 in both, so there's 3 in the answer.
So the top one up here with the 0.15.
Yep.
How
does
that one?
Same idea. There's 3 significant figures here and 3 significant figures here. So the answer has 3 significant figures.
Okay.
Good question. Sorry about that. Go ahead.
Okay. All right. You already answered it.
Oh, did I? You had the same question?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Is there a shortcut to this? Because the first time I did it, I didn't do anything but the last part. Oh, never mind, because I had it. Sorry.
That's all right. All right, let's keep moving on here. We've done a lot of this stuff already. We just need to keep on trucking so we can get done this course for deadline. Dilutions of solution. Dilution of solution. Please make sure you go back and do all the learning checks that I couldn't get time today to do. The answers are all there, so try to work those problems out. Make sure you do the assignments in the book and quizzes online and master in chemistry. Lots of practice problems there. You'll have no trouble figuring that out. All right, now, dilution of solutions. So we've all gone to the store and we've all purchased frozen concentrate. Write this down for me. Dilution. Water is added, volume increases, concentration decreases, mass of solute is the same. So write all that down. But think about, as you're writing, frozen concentrated orange juice. This is Florida, so we always think about orange juice here. We probably don't buy it frozen, though. If you go to the store, you buy the little log, little can of frozen concentrated orange juice. And it tastes really, really sharp because it's concentrated. The water has been removed. Think of that as the solute. Now, what do you do with that? You throw it in a pitcher and you add four parts of water. So you add four cans full of water or whatever it is, and you stir it. So now you've taken that frozen concentrated orange juice solution, which is very thick and very tart, and you've added water to it. So now the frozen concentrated orange juice was concentrated, and you added solvent to it. So you've diluted it, right? Make sense so far?
Mm-hmm.
You're diluting the orange juice. Now the flavor doesn't taste quite so sharp. So you've added solvent, you've definitely increased the volume, but now the amount of solute, the amount of orange juice you put in the beaker stays the same, right? It's just spread out over more water. Does that make sense? So when you do a dilution, the amount of solute does not change. Everybody okay with that? Okay. So you take some seawater, take it home, can't drink it, it's hard, it's salty. You start adding fresh water to the salt water, eventually you can drink it. Because the salt water becomes so dilute in the dilution that you're doing that you can't even taste the salt anymore. Now don't do that, that's not a good idea. But you could do it, it could be done. Just it'll take a lot of water. Okay? All right, well here's our orange juice. You don't have to write this down, just follow along with what I just said. You pour the concentrated orange juice into a pitcher, so that's your solute, well, that's your solution. And the solute dissolved in that water is quite high. The concentration is very high. Then you add a whole bunch of water to dilute that concentration. You're adding more solvent. The amount of orange juice, though, that you added initially does not really change. Just the amount of water changes, right? More of it's coming in. So this is a dilution. Everyone's comfortable with this? This definition? Excellent. Really quick calculation here. This is a really no-brainer for you guys. Now, C1, V1 equals C2, V2. Now, what does that mean? That means the concentration of 1 multiplied by the volume of 1 is equal to the concentration of 2 multiplied by the volume of 2. Think of that in terms of the frozen orange juice. The C1 is the concentration of what came in that can. Okay, so this is the orange juice in the can, how concentrated was it? V1 was how much orange juice was in the can. With me so far? C2 is the new concentration after you've added water to your orange juice. So far so good? And V2 is its new volume. Does that make sense? Everybody? It's as simple as that. C1, V1 equals C2, V2 reminds me of a gas law. Boyle's law. Basically, it's the same idea, only now we have concentrations and volumes, right? So if you can do Boyle's law calculations, you can do dilution calculations. So far, so good? It's really not challenging, it's just you have to know how to do it. and you kind of have to practice it a few times to make sure you've got it down. And I can promise you the calculations that correspond to this stuff are really straightforward. Everybody ready?
No.
We gotta go, we gotta get to the math. Oh. Everyone's chomping at the bit. You start putting down numbers on paper.
I hate math.
Did you say that out loud? Just insulted everyone in the room? Just kidding. We all hate math, that's why we're in chemistry class. There's a reason why I bought a calculus guy, because I didn't like it. All right, what is the final concentration when 0.50 liters of 6.0 molar HCl is diluted to a final volume of 1.0 liters? Okay, now, on an exam, if you have that kind of question, look for the key words, diluted. That tells me it's a dilution question, because it's right there. So go back to the formula sheet and look for this one. C1V1 is C2V2. That's the dilution equation. So we're going to use that. Now we read the question carefully. What is the final concentration when volume 1, 0.50 liters? That's what we're starting with. Of 6 molar HCl. So C1 is 6.0 molar. So that's what we're starting with. That's what's in the can of orange juice. 6 molar HCl and half a liter of it. Don't drink it. Is diluted to a final volume. So we have a new volume, V2, is 1.0 liters. And now C2 is what we really don't know, and it will be expressed in molarity. Wow, okay. C1, V1 is C2, V2. Okay. We don't know this. That's what we want to figure out. So just like in Boyle's law, we want to isolate that expression by itself. We want to get that guy all by his lonesome. To do that, we multiply both sides by V2. And the V2s will cancel. C2 equals C1 V1 over V2. That's the expression we need to rearrange to. And then, once you get to this point, you simply plug in the right numbers in the right spot. Just be very careful which one you put where. C1, 6.0 molar. V1. 0.50 liters. All of that now is divided by 1.0 liters. Liters cancel, giving us a final expression in molarity. So just like in Boyle's law, make sure you get a unit that you need. So if we work this out and all of our units cancel to give us liters, we did something wrong. So go back and reevaluate what you did. Also, look for the logic. The answer here is 3.0 molar. So what do I mean by look for the logic? We're doing a dilution. So the concentration has to go down, right? Mm-hmm. When you do a dilution, the concentration doesn't go up. It must go down. And if you forget that on an exam, think about this. If you take the frozen concentrated orange juice and try to drink it, you'll probably gag on it. It's so tart, right? But when you dilute it, when the concentration goes down, it tastes good. You with me on that? It's hard to remember these things.
So the dilution always goes down.
The concentration will always go down in the dilution. Okay? And the volume will always increase. If it's not, if the concentration goes up, that's called a concentration. You're concentrating something. All right. So this answer has the right unit, and it fits the logic, because 3 is smaller than 6. We started with 6 molar, now we have 3 molar. So the molarity went down. So this answer is probably correct because it has the right unit and the logic is sound. Now you might have typed the number in your calculator wrong and got the wrong answer, so instead of 10, you get 9 out of 10. You know, you still get an A on that question. Okay? Not hard, right? Hope not. Boyle's law is just as bad, right? Come on, it wasn't that bad. Come on, you guys. Okay, I'm skipping over a lot of this stuff, it's so easy. Please go over on your own though, and if you have any trouble at all, come on by office hours at 2 o'clock on Monday in the library. I'll be there till, I think this week I'm there till 4 because I have a selection committee meeting at 4, so I have to skip a little bit of my office hours, sorry about that. But come on by, I have office hours on Tuesdays too, so come on by then as well. Properties of Solutions, write that down. Properties of Solutions. Properties of Solutions. Now, while you're writing that down, there's an old saying from back, way back when, back before I was alive. People used to say this about pollution, and they really did say it. The saying went, the solution to pollution is dilution. Now think about that for a minute. Solution to pollution is dilution. And what they mean by that, it's not really true, but what they mean by that is if you have, say, a solution for salt water, for example, you can't drink ocean water because it's polluted with salt. But if you add enough water to that salt water, you can't detect the salt, because it's just the concentration has gone down so much. See what I'm saying? So, in essence, the pollution disappeared. Well, it didn't disappear, you just can't detect it. It's just so diluted, but it's still there. See what I'm saying? So anyway, it's a funny little saying. I think it was back in the 60s, used to say that. The solution to pollution is diluted. Has anyone ever heard that before? No? Yeah, make me feel old. Solutions. Write all these little points down. Solutions are always transparent. They may have a color, but they're always transparent. Like Kool-Aid, for example, can be dark red, tastes like red. don't laugh, but we've all done it, right? What kind of Kool-Aid do you want? I want red. It's raspberry, I think, or cherry. Now, it may have had a dark color, but it was always see-through. You could always see the other side of the kitchen through the vase or the glass or whatever. Okay? They do not separate. So if you leave a solution to stand, like you just set it on the counter. So you take a bottle, fill it with Kool-Aid, put the Kool-Aid on the shelf, let the bottle sit there for decades. The color might change, but the solution will never separate. That is to say, the solute will never fall to the bottom, and there won't be any layering, there won't be anything weird. They'll never separate. Okay? Yes, the last point, sorry. Contains small particles, ions or molecules that cannot be filtered and passed through a semipermeable membrane. Now, that's a biology statement. A semi-permeable membrane is a membrane, or basically a physical barrier, that will allow some molecules to go through it, but not every molecule to go through it. Usually it depends on size. So for example, in a solution, the ions and molecules are dissolved up and they're usually very small, and they can pass right on through a membrane because they're so small they can just kind of go right through it. Okay? So a membrane is a physical barrier. And the ones I've seen literally have microscopic holes, or maybe a little bit bigger than microscopic, holes drilled in them so molecules can literally just seep through them. Okay? But the bigger the molecule gets, they can't get through those little openings. So that's the solution. Colloids. They're medium-sized particles. So the particles in the colloid are a little bit bigger. They cannot be filtered, but they can be separated by a membrane. Colloids. And we'll get to what colloids are in a minute. Talk a little bit more about them. And then after that, we'll hopefully take a little break. Okay, so solutions, colloids, and the next one, my favorite. Cannot be filtered. Everybody got it? I'm sorry. Wrong. I thought we were going on something else. Real quick, what's a colloid? Colloids are these kind of things. The ones I like to think about are yogurt. That's a colloid. Where is it? Milk is a colloid. That's a good example. The other ones aren't great examples, I don't think. But milk and yogurt are good examples of colloids. Milk especially is the best example because it has a lot of fat dissolved in it. The fat, you can't filter it out, but it won't go through a membrane either. So milk is probably what I usually try, my go-to example for a colloid. Fog is also a colloid, but fog is weird. Milk is a good example. Fog is a colloid. But it's kind of weird to think about fog because it's so like wispy. Milk though, everyone has experience with milk. It's thick, right? Especially whole milk, it's freaking delicious. This is where I thought we were going. Suspensions. Now we're talking. Suspensions. And that same student, remember this dude, this is 2 years ago, it's so funny. Suspension. This person's definition was, when you do something wrong in school, they ask you to leave for a period of time. Her definition was so elegantly written, correct in the wrong context. But anyway, it was funny, I still remember it. I still remember it. Whoever that student was, I don't remember who it was, but they were very clever. Obviously, I caught them off guard with the quiz. But anyway, suspensions have very large particles that settle out and can very easily be filtered. And they must be stirred to stay in suspension. Now, I like this topic because I like Disneyland. And you're all like, what? How do they even go together? Everybody has gone to, well, maybe not gone to Disneyland, but have seen the remnants of Disneyland trips. Inevitably, somebody always buys a snow globe. Mm-hmm. Right? We've all seen the snow globes, right? Little Cinderella or whoever inside the little snow globe. And you shake the crap out of this globe and little pieces of white plastic kind of sprinkle down around Snow White. And it's so beautiful and weird. The little white particles are suspension. The whole thing inside that globe is called a suspension. And the little white particles are what make it a suspension, those little pieces of plastic, because they don't dissolve in the water, and you gotta shake the thing to make the suspension particles suspend in the water. So they'll go up in the water and they'll suspend there. And then they'll slowly kind of rain down because they're trying to, gravity's forcing them down, and the water molecules are trying to hold them up. But gravity eventually will win and they'll fall to the ground. So that's a great example of a suspension. And it kind of fits right into our, you know, economy. Thank you, Mickey. Also, another example, you know, blood platelets, muddy water, calamine lotion, stuff like that. Take some sand at the beach when you're there this weekend, put it in your glass of water, stir it. The sand will have a certain amount of time where it stays suspended, floats around, and then it will sink to the bottom. That's a suspension. A lot of oral medicines, at least when I was a kid, you know, for little kids, they want to give them oral because, you know, kids are like, eh, I'm full. Anyway. You always had to shake well before use. Remember that? For those of you who are older, shake well before use and spoon it up to your mouth. It always had a chalky taste because the medicine was mostly chalk. Well, not, it's not really chalk, but it had a texture of chalk. It wasn't soluble in water, so whenever it sat, the medicine sank to the bottom, so you had to shake the crap out of it to get it suspended so you could take a dose of it. Fun, right? All right, colligative properties. Please write that down. Colligative. You can read it. I can't pronounce it today for some reason. Colligative. I can't say peculiar either. Another word I can't say. Anyway, colligative properties depend on the number of solute particles in solution. Now, things like freezing point lowering, boiling point elevation. That's kind of cool. Boiling point elevation, freezing point depression. Or lowering. That's interesting. So what that says is, if you add something to water, it'll change its melting point. What? How can that be? Wait a minute now. If you add something to water, you change its melting point. Well, for those of you who've ever had experience in the north, which was me at one point in my life, know that this time of year, especially in eastern Canada. By the way, my parents just got 60 centimeters of snow the other day. I love Florida. Anyway, they canceled school twice. Once for the snow, the next day because it was too cold. Now this is Canada, right? These are Canadian kids. They're used to the cold. It was so cold that Canadian kids couldn't go to school. That's called cold. So anyway, I'm glad I'm here where it's a little bit cool, but not cold. Anyway, in the wintertime, the roads generally will freeze. There'll be like a snowstorm or a rain, a light drizzle or something, and the roads will freeze with a layer of ice. That makes for fun and excitement. because your car can't stop on ice. It'll just slide on through. So what we do in the north to prevent that is we add solute to the ice. We dump something on it, and it's usually salt.
Why salt?
What a great question. Two reasons. One, it's cheap and readily available. That's the first one. Compared to most things you can use, it's very cheap. Second reason is, remember I talked about those hydrogen bonds that water makes when it connects, links up to itself? Well, when you freeze water, those bonds are very strong, and they kind of make a little network together. They kind of like, you know, they build together. When you throw salt on them, now the water has a choice. Do I keep interacting with my buddy over here, or do I talk to this new person over here? And some of the water molecules will actually start interacting with the salt and start trying to dissolve it. And when they do that, they mess up all that little integrated binding that frozen water has. So when they get in there, they disrupt it, it lowers the melting point. So now instead of melting at, say, or freezing, say, at 0 degrees Celsius, it might freeze at, say, -6. So it, you know, and there's some things you can throw on ice that'll take it down to -10, -12, but it costs a lot more money. Okay? Cool, huh?
Yeah, I was wondering why I put ice, salt in the ice cream maker.
Yeah, to make this, makes it colder. Makes the surrounding ice colder. Makes salt, if you do it right, you can get salt water down to -10, -15, -20.
That's
awesome. It's cool, right?
Yeah.
And it's all because you're interacting with the hydrogen bonds, making them, it requires more energy now to freeze them.
Yes.
It requires the removal of more energy, I should say. Pretty cool, right?
Yeah.
Now, we were talking about it, but here's the example of one. For those of you who have never seen one, I'll tell you what this is. That is a salt truck. That is the truck that drives on the road and throws salt all over the road. This little thing here at the bottom, that's called the spreader. The salt will fall out of the truck. There's a little blade there that spins around rapidly and throws the salt left to right and backwards towards you. They're nice to see if you're really, really struggling to get home. You know, if it's already snowed and roads are slick, if you get behind a salt truck and you know they're going to your general direction, you know you're probably going to be safe because there's probably no ice behind it, or there's very little. Anyway. Clear to properties. Write this one down. You know what? Let's take a break. We're back in 10 minutes. We'll start here. I just want you to see it all, bro.
Thank you. Sí. Keep us so cool.
Bubbles, if you want to do one of those sandwiches. How far from the contact that I did not look like a same region?
He got a idea on the last one, you know.
What is that, right?
What is it?
That's all I need. Open up.
Now, when we left for break, we were talking about Caligula properties and basically its freezing point, melting point, and the amount of ions dissolved in the solution dictate how well it's going to be lowering or elevating the freezing point or boiling point. Now, move on to osmosis. So let's go ahead and write the definition down. Osmosis, water or a solvent, will tend to flow from the lower solute concentration into the higher solute concentration, so the solvent. The way I think of osmosis is I think the solvent is going to try to dilute solute. That's what the solvent's going to do. So the solvent will always travel through a membrane to try to dilute solute. The solute doesn't travel through the membrane, just the solvent does. And it's trying to dilute the solution. That's on the other side of the membrane. So for example, we see these two beakers here, and there's a membrane in the middle of the beaker. So the two sides of the beaker are isolated from one another by a membrane. Now water can pass through that membrane all day long, like it's not even there. The little sucrose or sugar molecules on the right-hand side of the beaker, they have to stay on the right. They can't go to the left. They're stuck there. But now, there is no sugar on the left. So the concentration of solute is higher on the right than it is on the left. You with me? So that means the water on the left is going to travel through the membrane and try to dilute the concentration of sucrose on the right. Make sense? That's osmosis. Water or solvent will travel through a semipermeable membrane and from an area of low concentration to high concentration in an attempt to dilute the high concentration. That's what the water is attempting to do. Okay?
That's not thinking about it, of course. It's just doing it, but that's how I look at it or I think about it.
Now, the water is going to change until the concentration of both sides of the membrane are the same. It's going to try to equal them out. That's what it will attempt to do. That might take forever, though.
So that is osmosis.
How are we doing? Ready to go? Pressure, osmotic pressure. Write all that down for me. It's produced by the solute particles dissolved in the solution. So now, the solute particles dissolved in the solution are going to exhibit some pressure equal to the pressure that would prevent the flow of additional water into the more concentrated solution. So basically, the solute particles resist. Or they push back onto it. It's the way I think. It's how I think about it. Very simplistic way of looking at it, but that's how I look at it. And the more dissolved particles you have, the more osmotic pressure you get. Okay, that's the basic definition of osmotic pressure. Just would like you to know that for your exam. So basically, just write it down and look for it on the exam.
Definitely.
Okay. Yep. Okay. And read the book definition too, so you're familiar and understand it a little bit. And osmosis too, you know. Know the definition. Know the terms. Know the jargon. Osmotic pressure. Blood cells. Now, red blood cells, they're not what I'm about to describe. They're really not this. They're more complicated than this. But I think of a red blood cell as basically a semi-permeable membrane sac. So it's like a sack of stuff surrounded by a semi-permeable membrane. What that means is inside the red blood cell, there are things that can't get out. And outside the red blood cell, there are some things that can't get in. So it's a sack. But water can go in and out at will, more or less. It's not quite that true, but water can exchange itself over that membrane pretty quickly. So now, the red blood cells have cell, well, it says cell walls here, but I didn't write that. That's supposed to be cell membrane. That is semi-permeable. Now, in order to maintain the osmotic pressure, you can't change it. So it's going to pull water in or send water out to maintain the osmotic pressure, or else the cell is going to get some damage. You don't want that. That's bad. Okay? Must maintain equal flow of water between the red blood cell and its surroundings. So you want the solute concentration on both sides of that membrane to be about equal. Or else you're going to have issues with your red blood cell. Does that make sense? And the issues with your red blood cell, well, you don't want issues with your red blood cells because they transport oxygen. And any issues you could have with red blood cells would certainly be
Here we go. So everyone ready? We're gonna get to the fun part right now. Isotonic solution, write all of that down for me. Exerts the same osmotic pressure as body fluids such as red blood cells. An isotonic solution exerts the same osmotic pressure as body fluids. And they describe a typical isotonic solution there. Now, I like the drawing. The drawing has a nice, healthy looking red blood cell. Even the magnification, shows plump and juicy, healthy looking red blood cells. So they're ready to go. The water is going into the cell and water is going out of the cell at basically the same rate. So the pressure stays about the same and the cell stays nice and plump and can do its cellular function. That's an isotonic solution. Okay? So if you drop red blood cells into an isotonic solution, you should be okay. Everybody? Make sense? Isotonic? Write it down. Isotonic. Isotonic. Everyone say isotonic.
Isotonic.
Okay? Right, faster. Because there's more good stuff to come. You can get fancy. I want you to know. Right now you don't know it, and that's not good. Soon you will know. It's hypertonic and hypotonic, but we'll get there now. Okay, here we go. Ready? Set. Next slide. Okay. Hypotonic. Write that down. The hypotonic solution has a lower solute concentration than the red blood cells. So the surrounding solution surrounding the red blood cell has less solute than inside the red blood cell. So there's less stuff dissolved in the water. Remember, osmosis, water goes from a low concentration to a high concentration in an attempt to dilute the solute. So the red blood cells filled with stuff, sugars and salts and proteins and all kinds of stuff. The water doesn't have any of that. So osmosis says the water should cross the red blood cell and go into the red blood cell in an attempt to dilute the contents. You with me so far? That's what osmosis says it should do. The issue here is, though, that the old red blood cell has a finite ability to absorb water. You can't fill it with water all day long, or much like a tire on a car or a bicycle or a balloon, eventually you'll puncture the red blood cell. It'll break open by sheer stress on the membrane. Okay? Now, this is known as hemolysis. Hemo meaning blood, lysis meaning to cut. So blood cutting, blood red blood cell cutting. That's one very common way to break open cells. So if you're doing biochemical research, for example, and you want to isolate proteins, one way to break the cells open to get the protein to come out is to dump in a hypotonic solution, make them burst. Okay? And every time I did it in my career, I always said a quote from Star Wars. It's as though a million cells cry out at once and then suddenly were silent. Star Wars fans in the audience? No? I don't know, it's pretty funny. It's weird. I like to amuse myself. All right, so that's hypotonic. Now, the opposite of hypotonic is hypertonic. Hypertonic means that on the outside of the cell, the solution has more solute than the inside of the cell. So you dump a solution on there, and there's a whole bunch of, I don't know, something dissolved in it. Now, the water in the red blood cell is like, holy crap, we got to get out there and dilute that water. We just got to go. So all the water in the red blood cell starts to rush out in an attempt to dilute the water. Which you can already predict, that's a fool's errand, because there's not enough water in the red blood cells to dilute that big beaker of water. So now the net result here is water is exiting the cell. Through osmosis, water is just going on the other side of the membrane to try to dilute the solution. This is, and it causes what's known as crenation. It makes the cells shrivel up. And you can even see it on the slide. The cells have jagged edges, and they look deformed, they look unhealthy. They look kind of alien almost. It's not a good situation because they probably don't function very well after that. Probably don't go through your veins very cleanly. So that's probably a bad situation too. So
So we have isotonic, hypotonic, and hypertonic solutions. And they all do, one isotonic maintains the red blood cell, but...
So will the human burst that?
Will the human burst? No, I think it would hurt a lot. I think it'll be an isolated thing, like right where they ejected you. Unless you flood somebody with this kind of solution, I don't think you'd burst, you know. Even if you flood it, I don't think you'd burst. That'd be good for a horror movie though, right?
Have you ever seen
I don't want to talk to a horror movie. Okay. This scared me. Alright, so that's hypotonic, hypotonic, isotonic. Make sure you know those for your exam.
You were saying isotonic will maintain the cell.
Yeah, the cell kind of stays the same. Hypertonic, the cell kind of shrivels up because it's sending water outside the cell to dilute the surroundings. And hypotonic, the surroundings have no salt or low concentration of solute, so the cell has a high concentration. So the water enters the cell in an attempt to equalize the concentration. And as you can tell, that didn't work out so well for the cell. All right, so that's chapter 7. We will try to get some parts of chapter 8 done today, just because we're so far behind. Okay, now this is a fun chapter, I think. I like this chapter anyway. Acids and bases. And we show a beautiful assortment of citrus fruit. Limes, lemons, oranges, and grapefruits. Now this being Florida, the Sunshine State, we have a lot of oranges here. We also have limes and lemons. And I think grapefruit too. Just not, I don't think the commercial. Just oranges are commercial, I believe. Not sure though. Why do we show citrus fruit? Well, the citrus fruits are acidic. Citric acid comes from citrus fruit. It's good, right? They all taste good and they're all acidic. Now, do you ever notice when you eat an orange or a lemon, hands get sticky? It's kind of tacky. Do you ever notice that when you wash your hands get slippery, slimy, burning off? No? Ever notice that? You experience acids and bases. Acids make your skin feel sticky. Bases make your skin feel slimy or slippery. Those are general principles or general physical manifestations of acids and bases. Those are only two. There's more. That's what we're dealing with. So now, let's talk about acids. When we talk about acids, we have to talk about this guy called Arrhenius. Arrhenius is a chemist, or he was a chemist. He's dead now. A while ago, he defined an acid as anything that can generate H+ in water. So Arrhenius was talking only about water.
I should spell his name right.
H-E-N-I-U-S. Arrhenius said acids, H+, ions, in water. So Arrhenius acids are always in water, first of all. Now this is a rudimentary look at acids. It's not what we consider now. I'll get into more what we consider to be now. But for his time, that was a groundbreaking observation. Acids create H+ ions in water. That means, because they're creating ions, that acids, by definition, must be electrolytes, because they produce ions in solution. Now, another interesting physical property or physical manifestation of an acid is sour. If you ever get the idea to try citric acid, you can buy it. You can buy it in the spice aisle at some places. Middle Eastern food stores usually have it in bulk because they use it in their cooking. Just take a little citric acid on your finger and dab it on your tongue. You'll spit it out. It's sour. Very sour. What's that? Okay. If you want to taste it in another way, go out and buy some Sour Patch Kids, the candy. They're coated in sugar and citric acid. That's where the sourness usually comes from citric acid. Why? Because it's extremely sour, it's a powder, and it's safe for humans to eat. Acids will turn litmus paper bright red, or dark red, and they will neutralize bases. Okay, so those are the general properties of an acid. Form H+ in water, electrolytic. They are sour to taste, which is why lemons and limes are sour, so are grapefruits. Oranges are sour, but they have more sugar to make them taste a little sweeter. And they neutralize base. So now, don't worry about this. Like, I usually go into the naming of different kinds of acids, but I've discovered in my tenure here that it's kind of not that important. What I'd much rather do is for you to memorize the few acids I'm going to draw on the board. The ones that I'm going to draw on the board are very prevalent in our society. Okay? So how about this one? HCl. That's hydrochloric acid. Hydrochloric acid, very common acid in our society. You can go and buy it at the hardware store. It's called muriatic acid, same thing. Very dangerous, don't go playing with it. So that's hydrochloric acid. We also have sulfuric acid. It's also a very common acid used in our society. This is nitric acid. Nitric acid is also quite common. Sulfuric and nitric are usually used in industrial processes. Hydrochloric is used in a lot of things for cleaning. It's also one of the acids that's found in your stomach to help dissolve and denature and process food. Phosphoric acid. Phosphoric acid is, believe it or not, one of the main ingredients of Coca-Cola and Pepsi. Whenever you read the can, you see phosphoric acid. Tastes good.
Is that in all sodas or just?
I think it's in most of them, yeah. Colas for sure. So these are four examples of acids and their strong acids. And I'll get into what that means in a minute. A few of the weaker ones. CH2O3, carbonic acid. H4. This thing in my head. C2H4O2. Acetic acid. These are two examples of weak acids that are very prevalent in our society. This is the acid that results when carbon dioxide dissolves in water. This is vinegar. Vinegar acid. So carbonic acid, whenever you carbonate water, like Coca-Cola, Pepsi, all the sodas, they all have carbonic acid in it. Acetic acid, what's another really weak acid that we use in our society? Those are the two most common. Citric acid's weak. Vitamin C is a weak acid. Anyway, let's stop there. Those are sick. That's plenty. So hydrochloric, sulfuric, nitric, phosphoric, carbonic, and acetic. Now, let's take a little look at these three right here before we move on. We'll get into this a little bit more probably next time, but for now I just want to show you something. That is SO4, right? Everyone should recognize that as a sulfate group, right? Remember that from the chart? Sulfates are -2, right? How many hydrogens does it have?
Two.
That's not a coincidence. The ion SO4 is -2. It has two hydrogens. So when it loses both hydrogens, it goes to be a sulfate. NO3, nitrate. Nitrate's -1, right? One hydrogen. That's not a coincidence. PO4, phosphate. That's -3. Has three hydrogens. That's not coincidental. That's kind of good. That's how it works. That's how, when we were doing the ions, and I was like, I would just kind of know that sulfate was -2. That's because I knew the structure of sulfuric acid was H2SO4. So it has two hydrogens, must be -2. So what I'm doing? Anyway. It doesn't really matter, I thought I'd point that out. Just so you know. They come from there. Alrighty now, let's move on. Arrhenius bases. Arrhenius says that a base generates OH- in solution.
That's what Arrhenius says. So again, Arrhenius has to be in water. So, Arrhenius says bases generate OH ions in water. So for example, NaOH, H2O, you get sodium plus, plus OH minus. There's your Arrhenius base right there. Okay? Now, bases make your hands feel slimy. They also taste bitter or chalky. They're nasty. Now, if you ever want to taste a base, I don't recommend it, but you can do it. Mm-hmm. Wash your mouth out with soap. That's a base. Most, I shouldn't say all of them, most soaps are basic. And most soaps taste nasty. Okay? What else? They're slippery when you touch them. They do that. They're also electrolytes. Notice they're positive and negative ions. That's a strong electrolyte. It's a strong base, strong electrolyte. And they neutralize acids. And they generally turn liquids blue. Yeah?
Bleach
is basic. Very good. Good example of a base. Bleach is this. That's bleach, sodium chlorate. So when you buy bleach here, it's called Clorox, right? Comes from the name sodium chlorate. Clorox, chlorate, comes from that. Good question, good observation too. And let's talk a little bit more about that before we move on. When you get bleach on your hands, which everyone has done, it takes forever to wash it off, doesn't it? That's another example of bases. Bases don't rinse off easily. Well, that particular base has its own odor. Most bases don't have a smell. That one does. Some of them do, but most of them do not. But yeah, that smell lingers with you for hours. So, lessons, everyone, you know, if you're going to go out to the club, don't be touching bleach before you get there, right? Now, so bases are slippery and they don't wash off very fast. All right? Good observation. Good observation. Now, well, let's just keep moving on. This is exciting, right? This is acids and bases. This is chemistry. Now, everyone took this class to learn about chemistry. Now we're talking about acids and bases. All right, so a few bases I'd like for you to remember. You don't have to remember that whole list, just a few of them. There are ones that, like this, NaOH, KOH, LiOH. These are strong bases. And I think everyone here can probably name those already, right? Sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, lithium hydroxide. You don't have your little ion sheet with you, but if you did, you would know that OH is hydroxide. Okay? So those are your strong bases. Now, when I say the word strong acid and strong base, you could exchange the word base and acid for electrolyte. Okay? A strong acid ionizes completely in water. So you dissolve a strong acid in water, you'll get H plus and something minus, so you won't have any of the parent. Let me just draw that up here real quick, just so we're clear. Strong acid. HCl is a strong acid. You get H plus, plus Cl minus. Notice the arrow only goes in one direction. This is a strong acid. The word strong acid does not necessarily mean the acid will eat your face off. It doesn't necessarily mean that. Now, some of the strong acids will eat your face off, that's for sure, but they don't have to, okay? Strong acid simply means it ionizes completely in water, much like a strong electrolyte.
Battery acid included?
Yeah, probably. I think battery acid is sulfuric acid, so yeah. I'm not sure what battery acid is anymore. I forgot. Okay? Well, that's another point. Some of the most dangerous acids are weak acids, the ones that I know about anyway. Okay? So that's a strong acid. Now, HF. HF is a weak acid.
because the arrow goes back and forth both ways. Now, HF is a weak acid, but I consider it one of the most dangerous acids. It's very, very, very harmful to humans. Okay? But being strong or being weak doesn't necessarily correspond to how, you know, awful, terrible, evil you are. It just means that you'll ionize completely in water, or you won't. Now, this is a weak one. I should write down the word weak here. Strong and weak acids. Okay? Weak acids do not ionize completely in water. Strong acids do. So in a strong acid, all you see is ions, H plus, Cl minus. In a weak acid, you get a few ions, but mostly you get the parent molecule. Okay?
So a weak acid, you always have two arrows?
Yes. It'll always go back and forth. Mm-hmm. Very good. Alrighty then. Moving right along. Now, we've talked about Arrhenius' definition of an acid, and now we're going to move on to a more modern definition. Bronsted-Lowry. Bronsted and Lowry, instead of talking about H plus and the corresponding anion, they say that an acid donates a proton. It doesn't have to be in water. It could be in any salt. And they say a base accepts a proton. Okay? Arrhenius said a base was OH minus in water. Bronsted and Lowry say, well, not always, because you can have an acid in a different solvent. So why don't we just say that a base is a proton or H plus acceptor, right? Does that make sense? So let's say that this marker here is my hydrogen atom. So far, so good? So I am an acid. I have the hydrogen. I'm ready to donate. Okay? And let's say that this young lady here is a base. I will donate my proton to her. And she takes it. Because she's a proton or a hydrogen atom, a hydrogen plus receiver. I was an acid. She was a base. She took the proton from me, and I gave it to her. See how that works? Everybody okay with that? All right? Thank you. So I had the proton, I donated it to her, she received the proton, bada bing, bada boom. Okay? You don't like the definition? Think about it this way. I am the quarterback, she's the wide receiver, and I throw it. I'm not going to throw that. I throw it to her. She's the receiver. She took the proton. You with me? Everybody? All right, now, in water, when you dissolve any acid in water, now, it doesn't have to be in water, but in this class, we leave it in water. We just talk about water. Okay, so we have HCl plus H2O to give me H3O plus Cl minus. Whoa, my markers are dying left and right today. Whoa, what is that? H3O plus, wow, well, let's just look at this here. Let's look at water. That's the structure of water, right? And now we have H3O plus over here. That's hydronium. 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 Everyone say it.
Hydronium.
Hydronium. Now, Arrhenius was not wrong. He just wasn't complete. Arrhenius said acids will give up H plus in solution. But he never told us where they went. Now, you just can't give protons away. You know, it's like throwing money on the street. You just don't do that unless you're like balling, right? Make it rain, as they say. Now, protons always go somewhere. So imagine this. Well, here we are. I'm the acid. There's my base. I hand off the proton to the base. At no time did the marker touch the floor. I gave it directly to the base. And the base took it directly from me, right? At no time did it touch the floor. So hydrogens, H plus, had to go somewhere. It can't just fly off into space. Are you with me on that? So it goes from the acid to the base, and you form hydronium. Okay? Now, with that being said, in every acid-base reaction, there is always an acid and there is always a base. So if you dissolve an acid into water, there must be a base somewhere to receive the H+. There has to be. You with me? If you dissolve a base in water, there's going to be someone there to donate a proton and someone there to receive a proton. So far, so good? This is the definition. Okay? So now, in this equation, HCl plus H2O, I look here and I say, okay, there's a chlorine right there with a hydrogen stuck to it. Let's look at the other side of the equation. Here's a chloride with no hydrogen. So that hydrogen that was on the chlorine is now gone. Another way of saying it is donated. Okay? Here I am, HCl. I donate my proton. So I was a proton donor, or H plus donor. I was. I donated it to her. So therefore, I must have been an acid. Right? Because I was an H plus donor. Everybody with me? H plus donor. She received the proton. By definition, a base is a proton or H plus receiver. You with me? Everybody? Thank you. I'll come back. Don't get sleepy. So now, this must have been an acid. How do I know that? Because the chlorine had a proton associated with it, and over here it doesn't. So the chlorine must have donated an H plus somewhere. So HCl is a proton H plus donor. Sound good? Everybody? Okay. Now, let's identify the base. We've identified the acid. Now we have to identify the base. I am the proton donor. I am HCl. I donated my proton to water. Water is the base. Does that make sense? Everybody?
Yes.
The acid was HCl. Thank you. The base was water. According to Bronsted and Lowry, whenever you have an acid, you must have a base. The proton or the H plus ion has to go somewhere. It can't exist on its own. Okay? And Bronsted and Lowry say the acid will donate the proton to water because water is a base. So far, so good? Okay. Now, over here, we have hydronium and Cl minus. Let's go back to our little demo here. Here I am with my proton. Now, I call this little game, watch the proton, or watch the hydrogen, watch the marker. Whoever has the marker is an acid, okay? So I have the marker right now, so I'm an acid. I hand the proton off to my base, she's got the proton. Now, believe it or not, she is an acid, okay? Because she has the proton. Are you with me? But now, I had it first. So I don't want her to be called an acid. I want there to be some kind of asterisk beside her name. And what that asterisk is the word conjugated. I'll write that down. Conjugated. Because I had it first, therefore she can't be an acid. She is a conjugate acid. Conjugate acid. The guys on the right-hand side are conjugated, okay? So the H3O plus is a conjugate acid. They're on the right-hand side, and they got the proton second. I had it first, she took it. I am an acid. She is not an acid. She is a conjugate acid. They're not quite as good as us acids. I'm just joking around. I'm sure you're awesome at being an acid, okay? All right, so far so good, right? So I had the proton. She took it, she was the base. So I was an acid, she was a base. Bam, take it. Conjugate acid, right there, ladies and gentlemen. Conjugate acid. She's got the hydrogen, the H plus, right? But now what became of me? I'm not really a base, I'm a conjugate base.
because I don't have the proton, but I used to have it. Okay? So now, let's do that one more time. Here we go. This is fun. We're having a good time, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I have the hydrogen, or the proton, the H plus, right here. Follow the marker. Here it goes. I donate it, so right now I have the marker. So I am an acid. She's basic. She's a base. I hand her the hydrogen proton. She took it. I now gave up my hydrogen, my proton. So I become a conjugate base. I'm on the right-hand side of the arrow, and I lost the hydrogen somewhere. She grabbed it. She is now the conjugate acid. See how that works? That's all it is. Thank you. That's all it is. That's how you figure it out. Figure out who gave up the hydrogen or the proton. Whoever gave it up was the acid. Whoever took it was the base. And on the other side of the arrow, there. Now you just rename them. Whoever took the acid, the proton, the H plus, is the conjugate acid. Whoever lost it is the conjugate base. Pretty straightforward? Okay. All right. Let's try another example. Okay, there's another example of an acid-base reaction. You have sulfuric acid on the left, plus water to give us hydronium and HSO4 negative on the other side. So now, thinking about our little demonstration here, follow the marker. Who is losing a proton or a hydrogen plus, and who is gaining a hydrogen plus? The HSO4 is doing what? It's losing. So the H2SO4 is the?
Acid.
Once you've identified one, the rest kind of fall into place. Now, how else do we know this is an acid? Well, it's in the name. It's called sulfuric acid. It's one of the ones I gave you to memorize. So if you just knew that sulfuric acid, you can immediately say, this is an acid. Okay? And sulfuric acid gave up one of its protons. So here we are over here now, HSO4. So what's this?
A conjugate base.
That's a conjugate base. Very good. Okay, now we've identified the acid and the conjugate base. So over here, if that's an acid, this must be a
base.
A very common mistake. And I think people are just guessing because they've forgotten. They say this is a conjugate base. A good rule of thumb is, at least in this class, the conjugate base is never on the left-hand side of the arrow. Never, ever. The conjugates are always on the right in this class. Okay? The acids and bases are on the left. The conjugate acid and base are on the right. So don't ever call anything over here a conjugate anything. All right. So what's that thing?
Conjugate.
Conjugate acid. Pretty neat, huh? Not that hard, right? Pretty simple. Just terms and definitions. You just gotta know them. You know what I mean? All right, let's move along. We did all that. We did better than the book did too. Ah. Strengths of acids and bases. Now, we've gone over this a little bit. I'm gonna just skip over some of that because we just went over it. I do want to stop here, though. Strong bases. Now, I just told you what a strong base was. No, I told you what a strong acid was. Let's go over a little bit about strong bases and weak bases. So now a strong base, sodium hydroxide, dissolves in water to give you Na plus and OH minus. There you go. Now, that's what all strong bases are like that. Now, a weak base are stuff like ammonia, and we'll talk about this equation here in a minute, plus H2O NH4 plus OH minus. That's a weak. So this is a strong base. That's a weak base. Okay. And again, just look at the arrows if you don't remember.
Oh, yeah.
There you go. Okay. Now, the one thing I always like to talk about in this class, because this is kind of a practical, like chemistry and you and your life kind of thing. Look at what bases are. Things like Eziof and Drano. Drano? Have you ever read the ingredients on Drano? Drano is a mixture of strong bases, usually potassium hydroxide. Now, Drano is very, very good at what it does. Drano dissolves human stuff. Think about it that way. Your drains are clogged by what? Probably your wife's hair. Not my hair, because my hair is too fine. But my wife's hair will clog the drain. Toothpaste, spittle from your mouth, other crap from you that falls in the sink and washes down the drain, clogs up the sink. What do you throw down there? Drano. Why? Because it will dissolve stuff, like human stuff, like hair. Okay, it doesn't really dissolve, it just kind of breaks it a little bit, makes it weaker. So now, Drano will basically decompose human stuff. Drano is usually stored where? Under the bathroom sink, right? What's the easiest drawer in your house for your child or young person to get into? The bathroom sink. Do not store your Drano under the sink. Store it somewhere high, or locked up. Because remember, this gentleman up here said he gets bleach on his hand and doesn't wash off real quick. Strong base potassium hydroxide does not wash off real quick. So you drink a bunch of it. You're not going to wash it out real quick. It's going to take a long time to wash it out of your inside. So, and that's going to hurt like hell. You might not make it through. Okay? Lock that stuff up. Get it away from your kids. I would personally, much rather, don't give this to your children. I never said to do this. But if I'm going to be poisoned by one thing or another, I'd rather have a strong acid. Strong acids, I think, are a little bit less painful, and I might survive it. Bases, strong bases like Drano, you probably won't. Now, Cheer, Windex, those are weaker bases. They're not going to kill you. They're going to taste very good. All right, but I always tell people, lock up, especially Drano. Drano is bad, man. Drano's bad news. It works really good at cleaning out junk from your drains, though. I mean, really, it works great. It's amazing how well it works. Anyway, let's move along. Ionization of water. Oh, I'm sorry. I wanted to do this weak base thing here before I move on. So let's talk about this real quick. Okay, now, let's go back to our demo. Follow the hydrogen. Now, I am going to be water. So I'm water. My two hydrogens right here. You can be the base this time. You're at H3. Okay? Everybody with me? I have the two protons. She's base. Okay. Now, she's the NH3. So NH3 comes and takes one of my protons. Took it. Okay. Who took the proton? The base. She did, right? She's NH3. So in that reaction on the bottom, who's the base? NH3. Let's do that again. Okay. I'm water. So I got the two markers. So I'm water. She's NH3. So I have two markers, right? We do a little reaction thing here. She takes one of my markers. Who took the marker? She took it, right? So she's the base. I'm water, so the NH3 is the base. Okay? Everybody like that so far? So if she is the base, then I must have been the acid. Right? Does that make sense? I am one. What did I say? I'm also the acid. I have a dual role.
So okay. Water can be acid?
Or basic.
Oh.
Say that louder.
Can water be acid?
Or basic.
Or basic?
And the answer is yes.
Yes.
Water can be either one. Water is acidic and it's also basic at the same time. Water's freaking phenomenally amazing. What it can do. Okay? So over here. The NH3 is right here. And then it becomes NH4+. So from going from here to here, the nitrogen molecule added one more proton or one more hydrogen. Is that correct? Went from 3 to 4. So that means somewhere between here and there, it accepted a new proton. Are you with me?
Yeah.
So this is a base. because a base is a proton or hydrogen plus acceptor. An acid is an H plus donor, right? The water here is H2O. Over here, it's OH minus. See that? So somewhere between there and here, the water lost a hydrogen. Is that true? So the water is the acid. Everybody like that? Okay. Now, looking over here, if this is a base, then this must be a
conjugate acid.
There you go. And this one is a
conjugate acid.
Conjugate base. Is it pretty straightforward? I mean, it's not that bad. Do some examples, though, in your text. There are some that are assigned. Do some of them so that you're not caught off guard on an exam when I ask you to identify. That's like a 5-point question to do that. So make sure you can do it. Auto-ionization of water. Now, it's likely practice it at home. You asked the best question right before the session. Is water an acid? And I said water is an acid and a base at the same time. Right? So that means then, in a solution of pure water, I can have an acid reaction going on and a base reaction going on at the same time. You with me? I can get both. So now, let's look at that. Here I have H2O, and here I have H2O, just draw it upside down. Now, the black water will behave as an acid, the red one will behave as a base. I don't know why I picked it that way, I just did. You could have done it the other way around, it doesn't matter, they're both water. So then, you'll form this. And the red hydrogen came from the red water. Plus, now, the red water is that. And that is in equilibrium. Okay? Called the ionization of water, or the self-ionization of water. Water can ionize itself. Okay? That's pretty neat. And it's because water has a dual role. It can be a base, or it can be an acid, depending on the environment it's in, which is very beneficial, especially to human health, and to a lot of other things, too. But that's basically, that's technically what's going on in the water. Now, well, I can't say basically anymore, right? I can say technically. Okay, now, in a solution of pure water, we can measure the concentration of H3O plus and OH minus. Now, at this point, I want to introduce something real quick. If you see this, square bracket X square bracket, if you see that written, what that means is the concentration of X in molarity. Okay? So when you see square bracket, whatever's in the square bracket, what they're saying there is the concentration of whatever's in the square bracket in molarity. That's what they're saying. Okay? It's just a shorthand way of saying it, because if I were to say that a million times, you guys would all freak out. I'd freak out too, because it's just hard to say. So what we do is we just put square brackets down there. Now, in pure water, the concentration of H3O plus is 1 times 10 to the negative 7. Molarity, or moles per liter. and the concentration of hydroxide equals 1 times 10 to the negative 7. Okay? So far, so good, right? So in pure water. Please put a square around these numbers, because they're going to come back. They're going to come back. All right? Now, I've got a few more minutes. Why not? Now, when you have a solution that's acidic, let's just bring this up. So we take, say we have a big old flask of water here, pure water, has 1 times 10 to the minus 7 hydroniums, 1 times 10 to the minus 7 hydroxide. And let's say someone walks up here and pours in a bunch of acid, so hydrochloric acid or whatnot. Now, I had a beaker of water and I added an acid to it. So that means my concentration of acid goes up, right? Because I added some to it. Does that make sense? So when I add more acid to a beaker, my concentration of H3O plus goes up. Does that make sense? So add acid. Okay, so when I add acid, the concentration of hydronium will go up. Now, let's talk about numbers real quick. I started out at negative 7, 1 times 10 to the negative 7. If my concentration goes up, what happens to that number? Does it get bigger or smaller?
Bigger.
This number right here, the exponent. That number gets smaller. As this number gets bigger, that number gets smaller, right? The exponent should go lower, right? So for example, I could have a concentration of H3O plus equal to 1 times 10 to the negative 4, for example. This number had to get lower in order for the number to get bigger, right? It's just like I'm trying to get you to look at the exponents. Just look at the exponents for now. Okay? Now, if I add base, the concentration of OH minus goes up. So if I add base, this concentration goes up. To negative, I don't know, 4. Let's do negative 4 over there too. Now, add acid, hydronium goes up. Add base, hydroxide goes up. Now, if one of them goes up, the other one goes down. Does that make sense? Everybody kind of like that a little bit? So if this one went up, if I add acid, hydronium goes up, hydroxide got smaller. So then in this example, concentration of OH minus would have to be 1 times 10 to the negative 10. Okay? Got smaller. If this one gets bigger, concentration of H3O plus would have to be 1 times 10 to the negative 10. Let's keep our eyes on these numbers right here. These ones especially. Okay? Now, again, if you add acid, hydronium goes up, hydroxide goes down. If you add base, hydroxide comes up, hydronium goes down, okay? And we're always worried about the exponent for now. And I'm harping on this exponent thing for a reason. And that reason, we'll get to it right now. Here we go, come on, come on, come on. I'm running short here. pH. Write that down real quick. Last thing for the day, and I'll send you home, I promise. pH scale. The pH scale. Now, looking at these numbers, and I know there's a lot of them right here, and I know this is kind of messy, I did this kind of intentionally. It's kind of hard to pick out numbers in here because there's just a lot of crap going on at once. So in order to make it simpler, we developed a scale called the pH scale. Now the P stands for power, and the H stands for hydrogen or proton.
power. Power is another way of saying exponent. Right? In math class, they go 2 to the power of 3. You know, 2 times 2 times 2. The power of exponents. So PA scale is dealing directly with the exponent. Now, remember I asked you, come on now, don't guide me now, don't guide me now. Remember I asked you to keep your eye on number 7. Number 7. When water is neutral, there's no acidity, there's no basicity. When water is neutral, the concentration of hydronium equals the concentration of hydroxide, and they're both 1 times 10 to the negative 7. Okay? When your pH is 7, you are neutral. That means the concentration of H3O plus equals the concentration of OH minus, pH 7. The 7 is right there. That's where it comes from. Okay? We're dealing with the exponent. When you're acidic, your pH is less than 7. pH less than 7, you're acidic. Much like there. Hydronium, the exponent here got smaller. So pH less than 7, which 4 definitely qualifies, you're acidic. If you're basic, your pH is greater than 7. Much like here. Here we have an exponent of 10. If you have a pH of 10, you're very basic. Okay? Can I follow what I'm saying?
So the negative sign.
The negative sign, there's a formula I haven't shown you. I'll show it to you probably next week. The formula negates the negative sign. pH is the negative log. So there's a negative in the formula to get rid of that negative. Okay? All right. That's it for today, guys.